So, was this thumbnail really clickbait? Ooh, I see your car moving here. Well, guess what? This is the episode where you see the final steps before I can actually drive my car out of my garage and take it for a first spin around the neighborhood without an exhaust. So, look forward to that because I'm sure my neighbors and the police must be really happy about that. Anyway, let's stop teasing everybody and let's get right into it. Join me. All right, we're back in the warehouse. So as you can see, I'm installing two bungs on my PPE swap header because I would like to install a wideband sensor. And on top of that, I would also like to know my EGTs. EGTs are useful when you're tuning an NA engine because that shows you how lean you can actually go because, of course, not all of you know this, but in theory, by getting a little bit leaner, you can actually squeeze out a few extra horsepower. But you have to really watch out that you do not go too high with exhaust temperatures. So I like to go like roughly to 600 degrees Celsius. That's roughly my limit, and my 2ZZ was running like that and it was really good, and I could get quite a lot of extra power out just by having slightly leaner AFRs for an NA tune. Now, as you can see, I TIG welded on both bungs, and on the left I have my EGT sensor and on the right I have my wideband sensor that is connected to my AEM monitor on the dash, and that is also actually going to be giving an input into my ECU so I can actually use that for closed loop AFR tuning and also AFR control under full load, which is really awesome. Now did you see that Spikey has been trying to lick me and attack me while I'm installing some more parts? Here you can see I'm actually installing my Kswap drive shafts that are by map, they are pretty good and they're rated up to 500 horsepower. So even if one day I decided to go supercharge or turbocharge the engine, I could still make a little bit more horsepower than this, or even the K24 block, I should have more than enough resistance to all that. So I'm putting back all my arms, and as you can see, that blue Cusco brace that I used to have worked with the 2ZZ, but sadly, and that I found it out only a little bit later in the video, is that it actually isn't compatible with the K series engine because it actually hits against various parts such as the oil pan. So it's a bit of a pain in the butt to put all these screws back in, but anyway, I'm leaving the camera roll because you can see some of my sufferance and pains trying to reinstall everything. So it's, anyway, I'm working through that, putting the screws through and hitting them in gently. Now I'm gonna go on the other side. So the good thing is, as you can see, this one, I do not need to insert it into the transmission. It has already the external shaft there that you can see next to the oil filter. So you basically just slide that one in, pull the hub out, then you can insert it on the other side as well. And the same process as on the other side. For some reason, this side was a bit easier to do than the other side. And putting all the arms in, finicking everything. And as you can see, I have a couple of lines on my various adjustment parts for the toe alignment. You have a line that you actually put on before taking it apart. You can actually put the car back together pretty quickly. Your alignment won't be perfect, but it will be pretty close to perfect. And you can then just do slight adjustments for your alignment, of course, as long as everything did not move too badly. So, as you can see, everything is back together. My beautiful Moroso oil pan, that on top of that actually was preventing me from installing my Cusco braces, as you can see here. And the Spikester boy is distracting me as usual during my projects. But anyway, it's always nice to have somebody. Now that I cannot motivate my kids anymore to come and help me, I guess the doggy is going to have to do the job. So, as you can see, everything is coming back together nicely. And let's continue on with the reassembly process. I did run into a little hiccup, is where the stock throttle cable actually does not allow my throttle body to close completely even when fully released. So I was trying to find out different ways how to improve this, and honestly, I did not quite yet find an ideal solution for that. So if you guys, any of you, have ideas in the comments, please tell me. It would help me greatly. Now let's move on to the shifter throw converter. This is a really nice kit that actually, since this transmission and engine layout comes from a front-wheel drive car, you need to convert the shifter movement. Otherwise, if you just hook up your shifter cables from the MR2, you will not be able to shift in the correct gears. So with this conversion kit that throws the shift in the other direction, very simple to install and perfectly converts the movement so you can actually shift into your six gears, including the reverse gear as well. So it's seven different positions. It works perfectly with the stock Toyota MR2 cables on the Honda transmission with this converter kit. So here you see me just testing everything, making sure everything works. And here I'm also gonna show you if my bleeding procedure for the clutch actually worked or not. And as you can see, it works perfectly. And all I can say is, if you have difficulties bleeding your slave cylinder kit, clutch kit, make sure to fill it up in advance with brake fluid, with one of the nozzles open, so you can fill it up with liquid completely, and then you will be able to bleed it without a problem. So here you can see the popular hose modification. This is the stock MR2 hose. You have to cut it short. I put an adapter for a sensor. It's always useful. And here you see me. I got a haircut, by the way. And I am putting back the stock hose clamps. I've realized that these clamps can be really a source of leaks, so only use them if they're really in good condition. And here you see me putting back all the leftover hoses that go to the expansion bays, and I have one last hose. So here you see, this is the final result of how it's supposed to look like, and you see both hoses going into their stock place. Surprisingly, somebody told me it's better to, I saw some of the tutorials saying you should actually shorten some of these hoses, but honestly, I did not see the need to do that. Those are just the stock hoses going back into the expansion vase, so that's all good. I also put that plug back on so I don't have liquid shooting out as soon as I fill it up. And here you can see a little bit how everything looks like. Also with the final hose and its clamp installed here at the bottom of the expansion vase. And here you see the other clamp going onto the hoses going over there. And now I just have one problem, is what am I gonna do with my battery? And I actually realized something really neat is, since, oh, hi Spike. I got distracted again. So I was saying, since my swap basically needs to use the left engine mount damper or silent block or rubber bushing, whatever you want to call it, this actually gives me the opportunity to bolt the stock MR2 battery tray onto it and bolt my battery actually in the factory position. So what's really cool about that, on top of the fact that I just installed my Cusco strut brace, is that actually a newbie who opens my hood will not even really see the difference, and maybe not even notice that the engine is from a Honda and got swapped into it. So over there in the back, you can see I still have this one depression hose for the brakes cylinder, or the brake booster basically. I decided to just extend the hose for the moment because I didn't really want to cut the stock one. And here you see I'm running into my next problem after installing my beautiful Cusco sway bar and strut bar, is that my Fujitsu Bow exhaust will not work with this header. So I'm going to have to build something. So now Spikey is watching me doing electronics, and I had to move over my expansion loom because I had plugged it into the wrong one. So I opened that up quickly. and I also installed the depression hose so I can actually go directly onto a vacuum line to get direct access of the intake pressure. And now, really important step, do not forget that, is to fill up the oil. So I hooked up a gardening hose to a funnel that I put in the upper hole, the filling hole of the transmission, and this allows me very easily to fill up the oil, as you can see here. And make sure to put a bucket below to make sure everything in excess drips back into the bucket. And as you can see here, that's a pretty easy way to do it. It worked out pretty well. And now I'm gonna be
putting the car back on its wheels the first time in a really, really long time. And I'm super stoked about that. It's been, I think, at least 6 months since the car was on jack stands. So let's see if it can actually drive out of the garage on its own for the first time without any hiccups. So let's check that out. As you can notice, I forgot my steering wheel in the back, and also, no, I did not forget to put an exhaust, and it's just that I don't have anything else. But a missing exhaust doesn't prevent us from driving, does it? Anyway, let's drive this baby out of the garage. First drive around the block with the MR2. Looks like Spikey's also gonna join us for the celebration. Come here, buddy. Say hello to Spikey boy. So, in any case, Spikey, don't distract everybody. This little drive around the block allows us to do many little checks, such as, does the clutch work? Does the transmission work? Does the engine work also? And so anyway, I'm gonna put Spike back down. So one can clearly see that that little drive, even though it's a really small little drive, allows us to check almost everything to see if it's functioning or not. And that's already a really big step forward. For the guys of you who have been really paying attention, you probably noticed that I did not yet fill in the coolant, and there's a very simple explanation for that. It's because I hadn't received my swivel neck hose kit. So this is the thermostat casing with a swivel neck that allows me to turn it in order to install my cooling hose. So that's the only last thing I really need to do in order to get the car tuned as well, because I did not want to let it run longer than maybe 2 or 3 minutes without any cooling water in it. Of course, oil was in it. So anyway, I'm freaking chuffed about this, because as I said before, that little drive around the block allows me basically to say with certainty that most of the things are working really well. So all I need to do now is the coolant part, and the next video will be the tuning side of things and running the engine in, although it's a used engine, so there isn't much running in to do, but there might be some dyno action and some link ECU tuning going on, which I am super excited to do. And then I think we should start getting back into racing with that car. So who knows, maybe I can still pull off a race with the car this year. So thanks so much for watching. If you like this content and if you're as stoked as I am right now, make sure to hit the like button. Tell me your feedback in the comments below. And if you want to share this video, well, please do so. That is a great way to support the channel. And Maybe just one question I want to ask all of you guys watching. So as a person who likes car apparel and things like that, I am highly thinking of investing in making more caps and clothes, but also planning to do my own racing harnesses and toe straps. So if any of you guys could give me some feedback in the comments below, if these kind of things would be of interest for you. And of course, you can surely tell that I'm doing all of this for free and out of passion for cars. So if I can get some investments back so I can go even crazier with all my car shenanigans and share more content with all of you, that is really the goal behind it, to make it a little bit more viable from a financial perspective. So anyway, make sure to tell me in the comments if there's anything you want to express about this. I would highly appreciate your feedback. And without further ado, I will close this video today, and I will see you really soon in the next one. Peace.